Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with the Quran, and he has said that يَتْلُوْ عَلَيْهِمْ وَالَّذِي بَعَثْ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُوْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَإِنْ كَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ فِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. That he has sent the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with the kitab. This Quran Majid is the guidance for us. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهُ هُدًى لِّلْمُتَّقِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala throughout from Sayyidina Adam alayhi salatu wasalam till our last prophet, he sent so many messengers, so many prophets. With them he sent miracles. The miracles with all the other prophets, like Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam prophet, his staff transformed into a snake, the glowing hand, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, he could cure the lepers and the people who were born blind. So all these miracles, they were there with the prophets. When they passed away, when they left the world, what happened was the miracles also finished. But the Quran, amazing thing, my brothers, is that this is a miracle. At the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it was miracle, is still a miracle, and it will remain a miracle till the last moments. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when these miracles came, like the miracles of the prophets, what happened was, Hafiz ibn Kasir rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions that miracles came according to the era, according to that age. So at the time of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, sorcery, black magic, witchcraft, voodoo, all these were very prevalent in the community. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the miracle to Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wasalam to combat those things. Isa alayhi salatu wasalam time, the science of medicine was rife. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the miracle to Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wasalam about healing the lepers and those who were born blind. So at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, poetry was very rife. Small child, a shepherd, he could spontaneously recite 100 couplets. There was this book called Asabu'ul Mu'allaqat, finest Arabic poetry. They hung that on the door of the Kaaba and they challenged mankind, can somebody bring better articulate Arabic than this, poetry than this? So at that time, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was an ummi, unlettered, subhanallah, the Quran started to be revealed and the challenge was put forward. قُلْ لَإِنِ اشْتَمَعَتِ الْإِنْسُ وَالْجِنِّ عَلَىٰ أَيَّأْتُوا بِمِثْلِ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ لَا يَأْتُونَ بِمِثْلِهِ وَلَوْ كَانَ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ ظَهِيرًا. That say to mankind, لَإِنِ اشْتَمَعَتِ الْإِنْسِ, that all of you, if all the jinn kind, all the mankind, they all gather to produce something like of the Holy Quran, لَا يَأْتُونَ بِمِثْلِهِ, they will not be able to produce something like it, وَلَوْ كَانَ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ ظَهِيرًا, even if they assist and cooperate with each other. So Allah put that challenge forward at that time, 1400 years ago, that brings something like that of the Quran. So when this challenge was put forward, nobody came with the challenge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the challenge even more easier. Another verse was revealed, أَمْ يَقُولُونَ افْتَرَى قُلْ فَأْتُوا بِعَشْرِ سُوَرٍ. That are you saying that our beloved Prophet, he has concocted, he has fabricated, he has made it up himself? Then why don't you قُلْ فَأْتُوا بِعَشْرِ سُوَرٍ, then why don't you just bring 10 surahs then? You can't bring the full Quran, then bring 10 surahs. When they couldn't meet that challenge, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَإِن كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ مِّمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا فَأْتُوا بِالسُّورَةِ. If you are in doubt regarding what we have revealed to the Prophet, then there's no need for the full Quran, no need for 10 surahs, just bring one surah. The size of Surah Al-Kawthar. Do you know how many words in Surah Al-Kawthar? Only 12 words. 42 letters. Bring something like it. So that was the challenge was put forward. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concluded the challenge by saying, فَإِن لَمْ تَفَعَلُوا وَلَن تَفَعَلُوا. If you can't do it, you'll never be able to do it. Allah has made it clear. If you can't do it, so Allah said, وَلَن تَفَعَلُوا, you'll never be able to do it. So if somebody wants to refute, falsify this, he just has to say, okay, I'm going to bring something better than this. But till today, and inshallah till the last moments of this world, nobody will be able to bring something like the Quran. This itself is the biggest miracle. That's why it's a miracle. It was a miracle from the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was a miracle throughout, and it will be a miracle till the last moment of this life of this world. So it's amazing. What we need to understand is this Quran. What is our responsibility? This Quran is a miracle. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ Quran. Why don't you ponder, contemplate, reflect, think over this holy Quran? وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِي اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. If you think that this Quran was from anyone else other than Allah, لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافٌ كَثِيرًا, you would find so many different contradictions in it. But alhamdulillah, there is no contradiction at all. لَوْ أَنْزَلْنَا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ عَلَى جَبَلٍ لَرَأَيْتَهُ خَاشِعًا مُتَصَدِّعًا مِّنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ. If we reveal the Holy Quran upon the mountain, you've seen the mountain rent asunder because of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We as human beings, we have become completely heedless. So the point here is, we need to connect ourselves with the Holy Quran. Especially this day and age, when the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is prophesizing, يَأْتِي عَلَى النَّاسِ زَمَانٍ الصابر فيهم على دينه كالقابض على الجمر. A time will come upon the people when a person who's persevering on the deen is like holding hot sand on his hand. This is how we facing the problems. ستكون فتنة, fitna, trials and tribulations will come. سما بكما عميا, the fitna, the trials and tribulations will make a person deaf, dumb and blind. And then the hadith says, يصبح الرجل مؤمنا ويمسي كافرا. In the morning he'll be a believer, in the evening he'll be a disbeliever. وَيُمْسِي مُؤْمِنًا وَيُصْبِحُ كَافِرًا. In the evening he'll be a believer, in the morning he'll be a disbeliever. يَبِيعُ دِينَهُ بِعَرَضٍ مِّنَ الدُّنْيَا. He'll sell his deen because of the paltry things of the world. And this is what we're facing now. That's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, another prophecy he made was, يُوشِكُ أَن يَأْتِيَ عَلَى النَّاسِ زَمَانٌ. A time will come upon the people, will dawn upon the people, la yabqa min al islam illa ismuhu, nothing will remain of Islam but his name. What's your name, brother? Abdullah. What's your name? Abdul Rahman. What's your name, sister? Aisha. What's your name? Khadija. What's your name, sister? Zainab. Do you perform your salah? No. Do you observe your fast? No. Do you give zakat? No. This is what's going to happen. This is what we can see with our own eyes. La yabqa min al islam illa ismuhu, nothing of Islam will remain but its name. وَلَا يَبْقَى مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ إِلَّا رَسْمُهُ, nothing of the Quran will remain but its script. Every one of us, we have the Quran in our homes, on our wardrobes, on our top shelves. Nowadays we've got it on our apps. But how many of us we read? On Friday you'll get so many messages, reminder to recite Suratul Kaf. The person who sends the message doesn't read it himself. He just sends it. When was the last time you opened the Quran, we read it? Nowadays it's become a tradition. Somebody passes away, we'll recite Surah Yasin, we'll read one juz of the Quran and that's it, it's closed. And dust is falling on that Quran, we won't open it. In Ramadan, subhanallah, people, in Ramadan we tend to become Muslim in Ramadan, good Muslim in Ramadan. So you'll see the person just 1-2 days, they just hear that the moon has been sighted, now all the Islamic shops, people will be coming, oh, I need a copy of the Quran, I need the tasbih. The sister will say, I need the hijab. The brother will come, I'll need the topi on my head. So everything on that particular, and it's so surprising. And then from the day of Eid, back to normal. This is what happens. We have become part-time Muslim. There was a youngster in Bradford. So for the month of Ramadan, he used to come to the masjid even before the azan, all 5-time prayers in Ramadan. And he used to always say, you said you're supposed to be coming to the masjid early and you should be in the first saf. Look at me. On the day of Eid, I saw the youngster completely opposite direction at Zohar time. I said, brother, Zohar namaz? Mufti sahab, Ramadan finished? I said, Ramadan finished, namaz not finished. So this is the problem with namaz. For you is 12 months, for us it's 1 month. How can we worship? You know, I kept my restaurant closed, I kept my takeaway closed and everything. Now, what's going to happen? How long am I going to stay without my sustenance? Allahu Akbar. This is the mentality. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu dukhulu fis silmi kaffa, enter Islam entirely. We have become part-time Muslims. This Quran, Allahu Akbar, we're supposed to be reading it all the time. That was one of the mission of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yatlu alayhim ayatihi wa yuzakkihim wa yuallimuhum al-kitab wal-hikmah. The three mission: to recite the Quran, to explain the Quran, to purify oneself. So what we need to understand, my brothers and sisters, is that we connect ourselves with the Quran. And how do you connect ourselves? First thing is, we need to start reciting. You know, nowadays we think to ourselves, many of our brothers and sisters, they ask this question, we recite the Quran, we don't understand it. We don't need to understand it. Even then we get the reward. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, man qara harfan min kitabillahi falahu bihi hasana. A person who recites one letter of the Quran, he gets one deed, one good deed. Wal hasanatu bi ashri amthaliha, and every good deed is multiplied at least 10 times. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, by way of example, he said, "La aqulu alif lam mim harf, walakin alifun harfun, walamun harfun mimun harf." I don't say Alif Lam Mim is one letter. I say Alif is one letter, Lam is another letter, Mim is another letter. Thus, we get 30 reward just by saying Alif Lam Mim. And amazing thing is, the scholars of Hadith, Subhanallah, Jazahumullah Anna Khayrul Jaza, they have explained and elucidated and expounded on this, that nobody knows the meaning of Alif Lam Mim. So the Prophet gave an example of Alif Lam Mim. He didn't give an example of any other words. Because Alif Lam Mim, the biggest scholar of Islam, won't know the meaning. Because Allama Jalal Sayyidu Rahmatullah Alayhi Tafsir Jalalain, after every time these huruf and muqatta'at, the isolated letters come, he says, Allahu a'lamu bi muradihi bidhalik. Allah knows what he means. So here the Prophet is saying, even though you don't know the meaning, you will still get the reward. So first thing, what we need to start doing is reciting the Holy Quran. We need to get that habit of reciting. Our pious predecessors, the Sahaba Ikram, pious predecessors, they had that habit of reciting the Quran at least once a week. They used to complete the Quran. They used to start on the Friday after Jummah, and they used to read one manzil. Like you see in the Quran, you have the seven manzil. They have put that to make it easy for us. If we can't recite one manzil, then we could recite three juz. If we can't recite three juz, we can recite at least one juz. If we recite one juz every day, that's 12 khatams in the year. So this recitation we have stopped. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one person asked that ayyul a'mali afzal, what type of deed is the best? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said al halul murtahil. Halul murtahil. The Sahaba ikram asked, qal wa mal halul murtahil ya Rasulullah? What does it mean by halul murtahil? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave a beautiful definition, because sahibul Quran yadribu min awwalihi hatta yablugha akhira. وَمِنْ آخِرِهِ حَتَّى يَبْلُغَ أَوَّلَهُ كُلَّمَا حَلَّ إِرْتَحَلَ. The Sahibul Quran, the person who is connected with the Quran, what happens is, he commences, he begins his recitation of the Holy Quran from the beginning, and when he goes to the end, he doesn't stop there, like مِنَ الْجِنَّةِ وَالنَّاسِ, there's a big full stop. No. He immediately starts again from the beginning of Surah Al-Fatiha and Surah Al-Baqarah. That's why you see, in the month of Ramadan, when the Huffaz, they finish the Quran, so in the 20th rakat, on the 27th and the 29th night of Taraweeh, they read Suratul Baqarah again, up to Ulaika ala hudam min rabbihim wa ulaika al-muflihun. Why? To remind ourselves that minal jinnati wan nas, there's no stop, we need to continue. Kullama halla irtahala. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gives a similitude to a person when he's traveling. He hasn't reached his destination. Our destination is akhirah, jannat. So until then, we need to continue. We finish one khatam, we need to start the second khatam. So kullama, whenever we stop, that's it. After the khatam, we do a simple dua, short dua. Duas accept after the khatam Quran. And then we start again immediately. That's the way we should be doing the tilawat of the Quran. On a daily basis, if you look at the life of the Prophet ﷺ, in many ahadith, he has mentioned the virtues of reciting certain surahs. So we make a habit of reciting. We get that noble habit of reciting. Like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Inna fil Qur'ani suratan salasuna ayah shafa'at li rajulin hatta ghufira lahu." That in the Quran there is a surah which has 30 verses. It will intercede for the person until he is forgiven. And wahiya tabarak alladhi biyadil mulk. And he said, this is Suratul Mulk. How many of us we recite this? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says regarding him, he never used to go to sleep without reciting it. And what is the benefit, what's the virtues of this? A person will be safeguarded, protected from the punishment of the grave. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was no question about punishment of the grave for him. But why did he do this? Ta'aliman lil ummah, to teach us, oh my beloved ummati, oh my beloved followers, please recite it. I don't want to see any pain and agony falling on you. How much he cared for us. He said, I desire that every of my ummati knows Suratul Mulk. So reciting Suratul Mulk every night, the Prophet ﷺ used to recite Surah Sajda as well. Now we are always worried about our sustenance. You know, poverty will strike us and this will happen, our financial difficulties. So subhanAllah, the Prophet ﷺ has said about Suratul Waqiyah, is Suratul Ghina, the surah which makes you rich, wealthy. So once Sayyiduna Uthman Ghani radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he came to meet Sayyiduna Abdullah Masud radiyallahu anhu, who was very ill. He was bedridden, he was in his last moments. And he said to him, it seems that you might be leaving this world, you got daughters behind, so do you want me to stipulate any kind of monetary help for them. So Sayyidina Abdul Mas'ud radiallahu anhu said, there's no need. He goes, why not? He says, then he mentioned the hadith. Man qara'a surat al-waqi'ati fi kulli laylatin lam tusibhu faqatun abadan. That a person who recites surah al-waqi'a every night, faqa, poverty will never strike him. And Abdullah Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says that I've ordered all my daughters to constantly, punctually, steadfastly recite Surah Al-Waqi'ah every night. Alhamdulillah, recited. Look at that conviction they had. And we worried about our sustenance, we worried about this. These people, subhanAllah, they use the prophetic remedies. We will use everything of the worldly things. We won't try using the method which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has prescribed for us. So we need to make the habit of reciting the Quran as much as possible. On a daily basis, what we need to do, my brothers and sisters, we need to allocate some time. We need to have a timetable in our lives, because our timetable, what's happened is, we are living a life which is no different to a non-Muslim. We Muslim, we have to have a life which follows strict guidelines. You know, every one of us, when we go to sleep, subhanAllah, Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi mentions this hadith in Kitab al-Tahajjud. And he says that when a person goes to sleep, whether he's a Muslim, non-Muslim, practicing, non-practicing, he says, يَعْقِدُ الشَّيْطَانُ عَلَىٰ قَافِيَةِ رَأْسِكُمْ إِذَا هُوَ نَامَ ثَلَاثُ أُقَدْ. Every one of us, when we go to sleep, the shaitan, he blows on our forehead and he draws and he ties three knots. And he says, يَدْرِبُ كُلَّ أُقْدَةٍ عَلَيْكَ لَيْلٌ تَوِيلٌ. He blows on each one, he says, عَلَيْكَ لَيْلٌ تَوِيلٌ. Have a long night. Farquud, go to sleep. Don't wake up for Fajr Salah. That's, the shaitan doesn't want us to wake up. So he said, Alayka laylun tawil farquud. Go to sleep, have a long night. So we are busy with our social media and all the rest of it. And we will not be waking up. So basically, how do we tackle this? Our beloved Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has taught us that فَإِنْ إِسْتَيْقَظَ فَذَكَرَ اللَّهِ إِنْ حَلَّتْ أُقْدَى. That when we wake up in the morning and we do the dhikr of Allah, what is the dhikr of Allah here? The dua. Alhamdulillahi alladhi ahyana ba'dama amatana wa ilayhi nushur. Allah, all praises be to you. You have given us life after death. Because Allah, bismika amutu ahya, we died with your name and we will resurrect, we will get up with your name. So we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we reminding ourselves, alhamdulillah, Allah, I've woken up now, but a time will come, I will not wake up wa ilayhi nushur. I have to go back to you. That dhikr is very important. So that time, Allahu Akbar, many of us, we forget the dhikr. If we do wake up, the first thing we'll be looking at is our mobile phone to see the latest messages. We forget about the dhikr. So if we do the dhikr, we do the dua, in halat uqda. The hadith says, the first knot is untied. Remember, we got three knots. Then it says, فَإِن تَوَضَّعَ إِن حَلَّتْ uqda. If we perform our wuzu, the second knot is taken off. And then he says, فَإِن صَلَّى إِنْ حَلَّتْ أُقْدَى. Then if we perform our fajr, then the third knot is taken off. You know, amazing thing, the scholars of hadith expound on this, that which namaz is referred to. So they say it's referring to the fajr two rakat sunnah. And he says that in the fajr two rakat sunnah, the Prophet ﷺ noble habit was, in the first rakat to read قُلْ يَيُّ الْكَافِرُونَ, second rakat to read قُلْ وَاللَّهُ وَحَدٌ. And Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anhu says, sometimes I used to observe the Prophet ﷺ reading the two rakat sunnah so quickly. I used to think, did he read his Surah Al-Fatiha so quick? And the scholars have mentioned the reason why, because he wants that the third knot is taken off very quickly. So for us, the three knots are taken off. And then what does the hadith say? That a person, subhanallah, all the knots will be taken off. And the Quran is telling us that Fajr Salah, Aqimis Salata Liduluki Shamsi ila Ghasaqil Layli wa Quran al Fajr, Inna Quran al Fajri Kana Mashhuda. The Fajr time, the angels are present, read your namaz, make it long, the recitation. Because why? Now all the knots are taken off. Now you are, the hadith says, Wa illa asbaha tayyiban nafs, nashitan tayyiban nafs. The hadith says, when the three knots are taken off, that nashitan, you are very energetic, you are active. Tayyiban nafs, nasheet. Nasheet means active. And you're feeling very good. You're feeling fresh. We see it. Let us try it ourselves. That the day we wake up for Fajr Salah, mashallah, we are energetic, we are active, we are fresh. If you don't wake up in that way, and unfortunately for many brothers and sisters, this is the case. Majority of brothers and sisters. I was in Portugal in one masjid in Lisbon. So they said they have 6 jamaat just for Jummah Salah. 6 jamaat. That's how many Muslims we have. But Fajr Salah, it will be hardly one saf. So what has happened is, as I mentioned before, we have become part-time Muslims. So if we wake up in the morning in that way, subhanAllah, we'll be fresh. But if we don't wake up, and that's the majority, the hadith says, وَإِلَّا أَصْبَحَ خَبِيسَ النَّفْسِ كَسْلَانِ. We'll be waking up in the morning, where we'll be very lethargic, very tired, we'll be very lazy. And this is how the majority of the scholars, majority of the people, they are waking up. So unfortunately, what we need to do is, my brothers, is wake up in the morning, perform our Fajr Salah. Man salla salata subhi fahuwa fi dhimmatillah. The person who performs his Fajr Salah is under the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let us start off with our Fajr Salah. Start off by reciting Surah Yasin. Man qara yasin fi sadri nahar qudiyat hawaiju. The person who recites Surah Yasin in the morning, all his needs are fulfilled. Let us start our day in that way. So first thing is, getting the habit of reciting the Quran on a daily basis. As I said, if you can't read one manzil, we read 3 juz. If you can't read 3 juz, we read 1 juz. If you can't even read 1 juz, even if you can read a quarter juz, even then, subhanallah, we'll be able to finish 3 khatams in a year. Many of us, we don't even read 1 khatam in the full year. So tilawat kitab is very, very important. Utlu ma uhi ilayka min al-kitab wa aqim as-salah. That's the first responsibility we have. Number 2 is ta'alim kitab. Try to understand. هذا كتاب أنزلناه مبارك ليدبروا آياته ولتذكروا أولو الألباب. This Quran has been revealed and we don't want to know what it's telling us. We're reciting Surah Al-Fatiha all our entire life. We don't know the meaning of Surah Al-Fatiha. When we get a letter from the government, something we don't understand, we'll take it to the lawyer, we'll take it to our solicitors, we'll take it to a person who's got knowledge of it, and they'll explain to us. This letter, the Quran, has come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is our constitution. We don't want to know what it's telling us. So second responsibility is trying to understand. Try to listen to the tafsir of the Holy Quran from authentic scholars. Study the books of authentic scholars, the tafsir, the commentary, like tafsir ibn Kathir. So, tafsir al-Qurtubi, all these different tafsir, study them. They will give you insight to the Holy Quran. The third duty is, we need to practice. How many times in the Quran Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, aqimus salah, aqimus salah, establish prayer, establish prayer. How many of us we do that? So this ruling, so practicing what we are reading, what we are studying, we need to practice. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullah alayhi subhanallah, he says regarding him, it's amazing. From the 4 Imams, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullah alayhi, he says, Ma balagani hadithun illa hafiztuhu. Whenever I heard a hadith from my teachers, from the muhaddithun, I memorized the hadith. Wa ma hafiztuhu illa amiltuhu. And any hadith I memorize, I practice on that. Every hadith. Subhanallah. And it wasn't one hadith or 2 hadith. Scholars say up to 1,000,000 ahadith Imam Ahmad ibn Muhammad rahmatullah knew and he practiced on. This is the thing, that the practical side of things is zero. Everything is in the Holy Quran. مَا فَرَّطْنَا فِي الْكِتَابِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. Nothing has been left which is ambiguous. Nothing has been left which is vague. Allah has made everything clear. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has explained everything for us. Layluha ka nahariha wa naharuha ka layliha. The night like the day like the night. Everything is so clear, crystal clear. So practical side of things, we need to put the practice. We need to practice upon the Quran. And the amazing thing about our pious predecessors, subhanallah, whatever they read, they practice. Zainul Abidin rahimahullah ta'ala, the son of Hussein radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he was seated, he told one of his servants to bring some water for performing wuzu, and by mistake, accidentally, the water bottle fell on his head and he injured his head. He got very angry. And at that time, the servant, he recited the verse of the Quran, وَلَكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظِ. Allah praises those people who subdue the anger. So just imagine at that time how angry he will become. Huh? He does this and now he's, you know, reciting verses of the Holy Quran, teaching me. So immediately Allahu Akbar, he said, قَضَمْتُ غَيْذِي. I subdue my anger. Then he read the second part of the verse, وَلَعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ. Those people who forgive. He said, Afawtu anka, I've forgiven you. Then he said, Wallahu yuhibbul muhsin. Allah loves those people who do good deeds. He goes, Innaka hurrun li wajhillah. Indeed, you are free for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Uwayn ibn Hiss, the uncle of Hur ibn Qais, he came in his cabinet, in his meeting, and he was ignorant regarding the status of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala, the Khalifa, the great Khalifa of Islam. And he said, Oh Ibn al-Khattab, he called him Ibn al-Khattab, Oh Khattab son, you don't do justice, you don't distribute the wealth properly. So he was so angry, he was about to pounce on him. So Hur ibn Qais intercepted, he said, Ya Amil al-Mu'mineen, khudh al-af wa amur bil-urf wa a'rid anil jahilin. Khudh al-af, get hold of forgiveness, enjoin good, and ignore the ignorant. He's an ignorant person, my uncle, he might be my uncle, but he's ignorant. He said, وَكَانَ وَقَّافًا عِنْدَ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ Umar radiallahu ta'ala, he did not even move an inch forward. He stayed away. وَكَانَ وَقَّافًا He just froze. He paused at that moment of time. Allahu Akbar. This was the thing about these people. Immediately, when Fudhayl ibn Iyad rahimahullah ta'ala, he was one of the leaders of the dacoits, the thieves, the burglars of his time. So, people used to be so scared. Mothers used to put the children to sleep by saying, look, if you don't go to sleep, Fudhayl ibn Iyad is coming. And children used to go to sleep. That's how scared they were. So what happened was, subhanAllah, one night he was going and he was about to go into this person's house to burgle. And look at when Allah wants to change somebody, he makes the means. So the person in that house, he was reciting the Quranic verse, أَلَمْ يَأْنِ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْ تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَمَا نَزَلَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ Hasn't the time come for the believers that they humble for the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and what has been revealed from the truth? So when he heard this, obviously he understood Arabic, immediately he knelt down onto the ground and he said, he hit him like a rock. And he said, Bala ya Rabbi, qad ana wa qad hana. Oh my Lord, indeed the time has come, and the time has come and the time is now. Immediately he changed himself. This was the amazing thing about our pious predecessors. We need to make that change. We need to ask ourselves, Fudhayl ibn Iyad rahimahullah ta'ala, he changed himself, he responded positively. Are we responding positively? Are we going to start reciting the Quran? Are we going to start understanding the Quran? Are we going to start practicing the Quran? The practice in the Quran is the third thing. وَهَذَا كِتَابٌ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ مُبَارَكٌ فَاتَّبِعُوهُ وَاتَّقُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ That this Quran has been revealed, follow it. It's for our guidance. And the fourth thing, when we have practice the Quran, it doesn't stop here. بَلِّغُوا عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَا يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ بَلِّغْ مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكُمْ رَبِّي Our duty is the same duty as the Prophet ﷺ. He was given the duty to propagate. It's our duty as the ummati. There will be no prophets coming after our beloved Prophet ﷺ. We need to pass on the message. So the first responsibility we have is to pass on the message to our brothers and sisters in Islam. So my brothers, the Quran has come for our guidance. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِي هُدَلِّ الْمُتَّقِينَ Allah is inviting us. وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكِرِ We have made the Quran easy for remembrance, for reminder. فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكِرِ Is there anybody to take admonition? Is there anybody to take a reminder from there? So we need to ask ourselves and we need to ponder over the Holy Quran and subhanAllah, all our problems will be solved if we can start to attach ourselves with the Holy Quran. All these problems that we're facing in this day and age, whether it's the coronavirus, whether it's all these different things, the Quran is saying, وَمَا أَصْوَابَكُمْ مِنْ مُصِيبَةٍ فَبِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ وَيَعْفُوا عَنْ كَثِيرٍ Beautiful verse, which will explain to us about the coronavirus, that any difficulty which comes is because of what we have done. Because we start to blame other people. Oh, it happened in China, it's because of their fault. Oh, Palestine, whatever, Baitul Maqdis has gone because of their fault. We're always blaming somebody else. We don't blame ourselves. We need to first look into ourselves. We are sinful. We are the ones who are heedless. We are the ones who are committing all the evil. And we start to blame others. The first thing is, when these kind of things happen, we need to turn towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. First thing. وَلَنُذِيقَنَّهُمْ مِنَ الْعَذَابِ الْأَدْنَى دُونَ الْعَذَابِ الْأَكْبَرِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ Allah says, we make you taste all this. Why? There's a reason behind it. لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ So you turn towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to turn towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to do istighfar and tawbah. We need to make sure who take the preventative measures. We need to make sure we give sadaqat in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Islam subhanallah has taught us everything. Whether we are in facing adversities, whether we are in a happy situation, everything. Islam has made it easy for us to understand Deen in every aspect. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the true understanding, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to fulfill the responsibility, the obligation which the Quran has given us. Recite the Holy Quran, understand the Holy Quran, act upon the Holy Quran, and propagate the Holy Quran. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.